All aboard! The spoiler train is leaving for Eldrain Station. Greetings, owners of fine luxury cardboard rectangles. Welcome to another Eldrain spoiler video. My God, I am loving this set. It is dripping with flavor. Now, before we dive into that, I have been getting reports from multiple people that they keep missing all of my live streams. Now, I live stream usually at least twice a day. If you want to make sure that you don't miss those live streams, get in my Discord. Get in my Discord. And also, if you want to make sure you don't miss live streams, make sure you subscribe to the channel. That would help. So, with no further adoing, let us do it. Let us take a look at these glorious spoilers. We are starting out with Emberith Shieldbreaker, and oh my God, do I love the stylistic choices for these collector edition storybook cards. Now that to me is a little bit lamentable because in all honesty, the collector packs are out of my price range, but ideally I'll be able to pick up some of the cards from them at least because I find these to be gorgeous. And since we are on the subject of the Storytime cards, I will also explain to you how they work now, because the information about that has come down the chain. So, let's take a look at Emberith Shieldbreaker. One red, one colorless for a 2/1. The flavor text is, Courage is the only shield I need. This is technically a vanilla creature. A vanilla creature is a creature with no abilities whatsoever. So this is just a 2/1 for two, but you'll notice down in the left-hand corner, it does say, Battle display, one red, sorcery dash adventure, destroy target artifact. So, when you originally play this spell, you have a choice. Do I want to play this as a creature, or do I want to cast this as a sorcery? Now, if you do the sorcery first, it actually exiles the spell, and you can recast it as the creature. So you can choose to do the battle display first, then you would exile Emberith Shieldbreaker, and you can cast it as normal for the creature side. So you originally get to choose, am I going to cast it as a creature or a sorcery? And you can have both, but you do have to have the sorcery cast first. You do not have the option to play it as a creature and then try and cast the sorcery side of it. So the battle display is destroying an artifact. This is called Emberith Shieldbreaker. You can see the artwork is a shield being cut in half with a big funky looking sword. Now the coloration on this, the red and the white and the black, it very much makes me think of the servants of the Red Queen from Alice in Wonderland. It's got that kind of vibe. Overall, the stylistic nature of this artwork is fantastic to me. These cards look so good in this style. And there's so much red in the background of this artwork. I don't know exactly how to describe this particular style of painting, but I absolutely love it. And the force that is being shown with the shield being shorn in half is very, very compelling. I mean, it speaks to the whole battle display. That's what's going on here. A shield is being cleft in half. It also shows why this human being, because this is a human knight, would be more than a 1/1. Look at the sheer brute strength involved with cutting a shield in half. That is incredible. After that, oh God, guys, Garruk. Garruk is back. Can you believe it? Garruk is back and they tricked us. They tricked me. The wordplay that they chose, they said there was going to be three Planeswalker cards and one was a new one. So I had ruled Garruk out. I said Garruk was not going to be in the set. It wasn't a possibility because we were going to get Will, we were going to get Rowan, and we were going to get a mystery Planeswalker later determined to be Oko. But they pulled a fast one. Will and Rowan exist on their own card. And we will get to that in a future video. I can only do so many spoilers per video, guys. These take a lot of time to put together. And there's no way that I can crank through like 50 spoilers in 20-something minutes. If you want that, head on over to Bad Boy Gaming, because he's got that. I saw he just put up a spoiler with like 50 some odd cards in it. So if you really want to just have somebody fly through the cards and not hit you with the flavor, head on over. Me and Bad Boy are friends now, so this is totally fine. I'll give him a free shout out because, in all honesty, his channel's struggling. He's only got like, I don't know, 95,000 subscribers. He's not doing as well over here with me as with my 18K. Wait, no, I'm bad at math. Okay, so Garruk Cursed Huntsman. Again, this is the version of him that will show up in the collector's pack. I mean, the regular version will still have the same abilities, but this is the artwork that will show up in the collector's pack. So, one green, one black, four colors for a 5 loyalty legendary planeswalker. The zero ability is create 2/2 black and green wolf creature tokens with, when this creature dies, put a loyalty counter on each Garruk you control. Now that's really cool. This is the first time an ability like that that increases the loyalty of a planeswalker is tied to a creature. It actually kind of echoes Ugin's ability, where Ugin can make you a 2/2 token and he also exiles the top card of your deck. And when that token gets taken out, you get the card that was exiled. It's a similar sort of reward for the tokens that are being created getting destroyed. He's got a -3, destroy target creature, draw a card. So you can even destroy your own wolves if you want to accelerate and replenish his loyalty to a degree to make up for the -3. And he's got -6, you get an emblem, creatures you control get +3/+3 and have trample. Oh, as someone who just loves big fat creatures, I love it. It's so cool to see Garruk represented as the Huntsman. Yes, he's the Cursed Huntsman, but this is the Huntsman from the Red Riding Hood tale, the Huntsman who comes in and takes out the big bad wolf. And so you've got a wolf shown in the background, actually two wolves shown in the background, one of them peeking up into the casting cost box, which I enjoy. I think that's cute. He's just kind of sitting there with a little green mana symbol for a hat. So, I mean, the Huntsman destroyed a wolf, Garruk can make and destroy wolves, so that ties in. He looks incredibly brutish here. Apparently the hiccups or something are coming for me. Going out like a soldier. So, you've got Garruk here. This is him as a servant of Oko, which actually makes the spiky thorns that are showing up off of his shoulders feel kind of reminiscent of Oko. He's got that hood on that makes him feel like he's got an executioner feel, honestly. And he's surrounded by like this stunted, swampy kind of forest. He definitely has a dark feel to him. I actually have the book, the Throne of Eldraine book, and Garruk is featured in it, and he grows in size, and he's very feral. This honestly feels like it's on point for Garruk, so I'm pleased with it. After that, we go from Garruk to Gilded Goose. One green for a 0/2 flying bird. When it enters the battlefield, create a food token. For anybody who is wondering from our previous videos, we discussed what is a food token. Well, we have our answer. A food token is an artifact that has pay 2 mana, sacrifice the artifact, you gain 3 life. Now, the Gilded Goose's abilities are one green, one colorless, create a food token, so lay a golden egg, and tap, sacrifice a food, add 1 mana of any color. So this is a very Birds of Paradise feeling creature. I mean, Birds of Paradise tap for a mana of any color. When it comes into play, it makes a food token. The next turn, you'd be able to sacrifice the food token for a mana of any color or any other food tokens. You can also make food tokens. The artwork depicts the golden goose, the goose that laid the golden eggs. It is kind of like, it's almost kind of like a proverb where it teaches you not to be greedy and to build things, basically accumulate in a reasonable way. There's the whole thing is that somebody who owned the golden goose basically decided to throttle the bird so that they could get all the golden eggs that were inside it all at once and didn't realize that, no, it creates the golden eggs as it goes. So when they opened up the goose to check its insides, oh, look at that. There are no more golden eggs. And they basically ruined, they could have had an endless supply of golden eggs, but in their greed, now they have nothing. So it's this is obviously a straight up excellent representation of the goose that lays the golden eggs. It has the two golden eggs there. It's interesting to note that the tree right that it has its nest under has just been cut down, and the hunter has left its, or the woodsman has left his axe embedded in it. It gives it a nice woodland kind of feel, and I do like the fact that the Gilded Goose is shown in a more friendly looking forest as opposed to a more swampy looking forest like we saw Garruk in. Overall, this is a perfectly fine card. Now, connected to that gilded goose, we have the golden egg itself. Two colorless artifact food. When it enters the battlefield, draw a card. Pay one, sacrifice golden egg, add one mana of any color. Pay two, sacrifice golden egg, you gain three life. So this is essentially souped up food. And it's interesting to note that you have food tokens, but this is an artifact with the subtype food, which actually confused some people at first and made them think that these were the tokens when they are not. They are just considered food. This is something you could use with anything that says sack of food, like the gilded goose that we just said. It doesn't necessarily have to be a token that you sacrifice. And the artwork shows the golden egg compared to, I guess those other eggs must be like quail eggs or something like that, because I don't think geese lay eggs that are that much bigger than chicken eggs. So I imagine it's some other sort of wild hen. Now this has a very like Easter feel to it in a way, where it's just like, oh, I'm out there picking up the eggs. It's got a very nice countryside, idyllic, like spending your time going out and hunting eggs. I mean, it does kind of, at first you might look at it of, oh, did they drop the basket and things are in disarray? Because you've got the fabric that's laying outside of it. Was that fabric that was originally inside of it? I don't know. This just gives me a very chill, peaceful vibe. Moving on, we have Heraldric Banner. I really like this artifact. Three casting cost artifact. As it enters the battlefield, choose a color. Creatures you control of the chosen color get +1/+0, and tap it to add a mana of the chosen color. So for someone like me who plays mono green decks, this is fantastic. Also, we will find, and I don't know if there's going to be a card in this video with the ability, but we will find there are cards that specifically care about you using multiple amounts of one particular color of mana. Pay 3 red mana, for example, and it unlocks a better effect on the card. So artifacts like that will also help to serve that. Now, in terms of the artwork, it's serviceable, but to me, fairly dull. It just seems kind of like a guard post or a tower gate set against kind of a dark, rainy sort of moody kind of sky with just, okay, here's our banner on the post. In all honesty, the artwork on this card does not excite me. This is a low-level kind of filler card, but a solid uncommon overall. The next card is very flavorful to me, and I like the way it differentiates how there are multiple types of fairies in Eldraine with different goals and views on the world. One green, one blue for a 2/2 Marileaf Pixie. All right, so this is a 2/2 flyer that taps for a green or a blue. We don't normally see fairies in green. We haven't seen fairies in green for a long, long time. So, neither hostile nor friendly, pixies flit through the forest, seeking the treasures of the wilds. I like that concept. I like the idea of fairies that they're not all about instilling order. They're not evil or mischievous. They're literally just neutral, concerned with their own goals, seeking treasure. With the artwork, you can see this pixie. She's got her big, broad pixie wings. You've got a situation where she looks like she's kind of hunched up protectively, holding the treasure that she has. Either she's holding a treasure that she's hunched over protectively, trying to stop someone from taking, or that is her channeling mana. It is kind of difficult to 100% tell without having the larger artwork. Now, she's got this kind of streaked bandit skunked hair and a furry tail, which is pretty interesting. And these pixies obviously wear like little leather garments. You can see from the pants that she's wearing. Either way, I really dig this concept. I'm glad they decided to have a variety of these types of wildlife in terms of fairies and such. When you read the Throne of Eldraine book, you will realize that the story is one of mankind trying to fight against the encroachment of all the different fey creatures and just kind of carving out a safe place for mankind in a world that is teeming with all kinds of fantastical life. After that, we have Midnight Clock. The clock is at midnight. So this is 1 blue, 2 colors for an artifact that taps to add a blue mana to your mana pool. Now that's fairly rare. Blue artifacts that produce blue mana are not common in Magic the Gathering. 2 colorless and a blue, put an hour counter on Midnight Clock. At the beginning of each upkeep, put an hour counter on Midnight Clock. When the 12th hour counter is put on Midnight Clock, shuffle your hand and graveyard into your library, then draw 7 cards and exile Midnight Clock. So this is actually a one-sided time twister. And the fact that it's a time twister tied into a card that's a clock is fantastic. And the whole striking midnight has a very fantasy feel. Obviously, that's something that's tied into things like Cinderella stories, for example. This enchantment I've placed upon you, Cinderella, will fade at the strike of midnight. So by that time, you need to have awayed yourself. So you're no longer at the ball, and they will not see that your garments are returning to their normal shabby state. I like the artwork for this midnight clock as it's being shown in, like, just the pennants flying off and everything. It makes me feel like this might be kept in the Kingdom of Knowledge. There's different like stronghold kingdoms based on different ideals. And there's one, I believe it's called Varanus. The names haven't really congealed 100% in my name because in my head, I should say. They haven't congealed 100% in my head because I've been dealing with a ton of spoilers. I've only read a third of the book. There's a lot going on recently with the Magic news. We had those four new sets announced as well. So there's so much going on that I am just racing to keep up. I haven't even been over to Twitch yet to do the stream of Brawl Decks. I'm going to do that as soon as I finish recording and editing this video. So Midnight Clock is a very cool card. Although one nitpick I have is they did the 12 countdown, right? They're doing the 12 countdown of the cards from Throne of Eldraine. They should have either had this as card number 12 starting or as the final card, like we've reached 12. It just feels like they missed a flavor opportunity to match that up. Not a big deal though. After that, we've got Order of Midnight. Oh God, Seb McKinnon's a beast. What a glorious artist. One black, one colorless for a 2/2. Oh, I just had a sad thought. What if they just start to take Seb McKinnon and go, his artwork will only be in collector's packs? Ooh, please no. Okay, one black, one colors for a 2/2 flyer that cannot block. And the sorcery side of it is Alter Fate. One black, one colorless, return target creature card from your graveyard to your hand. So overall, not a terrible card. I mean, for black getting a 2/2 flyer, that, I mean, it can't block, yes, that sucks, but a 2/2 flyer for black is not something you get frequently. The fact that it's got a raised dead kind of effect on it as well, where you can bring a creature back to your hand, is also extremely useful. The artwork, just amazing. Just amazing. I don't know birds well enough to know if this is a giant raven or a crow, but it looks absolutely fantastic. You've got this gigantic crow, and you've got this female knight like hugging its neck as it's getting ready to take flight, I imagine. And I don't know, honestly, this could have easily been a green creature because while the whole thing has a swampy, dark light to it, just the little motes of light that are flowing upwards along with just the benign looking nature of this woman who's, and the way she's hugging the raven there, it all just comes together to feel kind of friendly and cozy. And I love her curved staff lantern, whatever you would call this. I absolutely love it. She has a big long sword strapped to her waist as well, but I really, really love that lantern. It looks fantastic. This artwork is so good. Seb McKinnon is an absolute beast. This card drips with incredible flavor. The Order of Midnight. They're knights that fly on giant ravens at midnight. At the stroke of midnight, they come descending with lanterns held out, and you see these lights, a group of these lights coming. You think, is hope coming? And then all hope is lost. I love it. And they can raise the dead. They can alter people's fate. How do they do that? Does that lantern allow them to alter people's fate? The flavor. It's so good. Speaking of good flavor, let's take a look at Smitten Swordmaster. One black, one colorless for a 2/1 lifelink human knight. My quest? Why to marry Ayara or die trying. That is dope. All right, curry favor, which is an attempt to gain favor with someone, in case you didn't know. It's not like, I did you a favor and bought you some curry at the grocery store. All right, one black, you gain X life and each opponent loses X life, where X is the number of knights you control. So obviously this is a knight tribal card. The artwork on it is incredible. You see the Smitten Swordmaster, and he's standing over a conquered dragon. And a conquered dragon is what you would seek to destroy to gain the hand of a fair maiden. The idea of a Smitten Swordmaster, this dude can slay dragons. Although, admittedly, that's not represented effectively with his creature side, but maybe on the curry favor side, where it's like lose X life, gain X life based on the number of knights, sort of, maybe? I don't know. The flavor for the everything doesn't come together perfectly in terms of showing why he would be able to slay this dragon, but my god, he's in like some kind of like dark moor, and you can see the trees are all stunted and leafless, and you've got like a little raven or a crow over there on the one branch, just kind of maybe is the eyes or ears of some sort of like bog hag watching him. You can see the moon there in the background as he stands over the dragon, and he's got a piece of cloth that he's using to clean his blade. He has literally just slain this dragon, and it's all to win the heart of Ayara. I love it. This could easily have been a white card or something else. As a black card, it kind of makes it a little more interesting because it's almost like he would do anything. He would do anything to get Ayara. Now, the last card we have for this video is Tournament Grounds. This is a very interesting land. It taps for a colorless mana, or it taps for a red, white, or black. But you can only spend this mana to cast knights or equipment. Now, that is an interesting restriction, a very particular creature type or equipment. It also transmits the concept that in this set, knights are red, white, and black. Blue and green are not the color of knights. The flavor text says, no one knows when the tournament began. All they know is that it will never end. That's incredible. A never-ending tournament that is ongoing at the tournament grounds. And the artwork depicts a bunch of knights charging almost in some kind of race. Truthfully, I'm not 100% sure what's going on in the background. I don't know if that's a giant fire or some kind of volcano in the distance. When I look at it, I'm admittedly sort of puzzled as to what's going on. But the fact that there are about almost 20 knights on this charging at each other, because from our perspective on our end, we can see all the knights that are charging away from us. But if you actually look really closely, you will see there are a bunch of knights on the opposite side charging towards them. So instead of jousting grounds where you have a one-on-one knight, you have all these knights striving to prove their worth. And if you're wondering why they do this sort of thing, there are 5 different scenarios that knights can undertake to essentially become acclaimed. And if they manage to attain all 5 of these like legendary statuses, essentially, then they can become the High King and rule over all of mankind's lands. And that is not a prize that's given lightly. It's not given to everyone. You have to be chosen by questing beasts, and you have to complete the 5 major quests. This is all stuff that you glean from the storybook, from the actual novel, if you're wondering where I gained this additional information. So my friends, that's all the spoilers we have for this video. There are more spoilers, but as I said at the beginning, I honestly can't, like, I take too long talking about each card and its flavor to do a video where we talk about like 30, 40, 50, 60 cards in a video. The video would be insanely long. This is 10 cards, and this video is probably gonna be about 20 to 25 minutes, I'm guessing, from the amount of time we've already spent on this. So again, I say to you, if you don't want to miss my live streams, make sure you join my Discord. I post all my videos in my Discord. I let you know when I'm streaming. I stream here usually twice a day, also over on Twitch, and sometimes I even pop up on other websites. So I invite you, get in the Discord. I invite you, hit the subscribe button if you enjoy what I'm doing. We're right on the cusp of 19,000 subscribers, and we're gonna have a fun 19,000 subscriber celebration live stream when we do. So if you wanna be a part of that, hit that button, my friends. And I say to all of you, my patrons and my channel members, thank you very much for supporting what I do. I put a lot of work into this, and I appreciate you guys giving me the money that I need to keep the ship going. So thanks for that, my friends. And to all of you, I say remember, together we are the 6 color of magic.